Happy Easter, everybody. Thank you for joining us in worship today. We're going to be doing things a little bit differently today, as if the last few weeks haven't been different enough. I have split my sermon up into six different sections. I don't want you to worry. Each section is only about 20 to 30 minutes long. Anybody go check the counter at the bottom of your screen there? After each of these sections, we're going to sing a song or two that will help us to reflect through singing on what we just discussed and what we just saw from Scripture. I really do hope you guys have a great Easter. I hope you enjoy worshiping with us. This Easter is going to be a lot different. We're not going to get to enjoy many of the traditions and family gatherings that we normally have on Easter and that we associate with this holiday. But we know that while we're going to miss out on those things, and there's nothing wrong with them, that's not why we rejoice. It's not why we worship. It's not why we celebrate. And so as we get together in God's Word and sing His praises today, we're going to celebrate Easter just as much as we ever have. Today we are celebrating the fact that Jesus is risen and the fact that we are forgiven and that each of us has a home way up yonder with one of its rooms waiting just for us. Strangely enough, this forgiveness that we're celebrating is very insulting to so many people. I have seen many people stumble on the path from atheism to deism, just the idea that there is even a higher power, that there is a creator. So many people refuse to take that first step of faith to believe in a God they can't see. I've seen just as many people stumble between the idea of a higher power and a God who loves us and forgives us. And the reason for this is we're prideful. We're really our own God so often. And the idea that we have to be forgiven of anything is offensive to us. And the idea that we have to be forgiven of anything that deserves hell definitely affects us and definitely hurts our selfish pride. And so when it comes to the gospel, the first step is a guilty plea. We come to a court and see the just God, who is the judge of the universe, saying, basically our verdict has already been cast. He's already said that we deserve hell. But when we come to that courtroom to give our guilty plea, well, we don't see a judge who just can't wait to dole out punishment. We see a merciful God who is sitting there, ready to forgive us. We see Jesus with his hands outstretched, those nail scars still visible to us. When we see Jesus with those hands outstretched and realize what he's done for us, it should not be offensive to ask for forgiveness. We should realize that no sin in our lives, no matter how small, requires his sacrifice and forgiveness. And we should also realize that no other sin, no matter how egregious, is covered by his blood. Blessed are those whose lawless deeds are forgiven and whose sins are covered. Blessed is the man against whom the Lord will not count his sin.
His mercy is more.
Thank you.
Given our sins without such a gross display? Was Jesus' death in any manner truly necessary? Well, God is a just God, and really, we wouldn't have it any other way. While we may all desire mercy for all we do, we would shudder to think of a world without justice. What is the verdict for a charge of sin from a just God? The wages of sin is death. And this was not a new idea in Jesus' day. The nation of Israel had been practicing substitutionary sacrifices for centuries at this point. If you look at Leviticus chapters 4 and 5, it spells out how people were to go about offering sacrifices for their sins. And if you fast forward to Leviticus 16, we see instructions for the high priest on the Day of Atonement on how he was to go about offering a sacrifice for the sins of the whole nation. And those sins were both those done on purpose and those done on accident. Because, as I've heard it said growing up, we're not sinners because we sin. We sin because we're sinners. It's in our nature. It's who we are. And that sin deserves death. Well, we see God in his justice is not only allowed for, but he commanded and showed the way for the people he loves to be spared from this verdict, from this justice, from his wrath towards our sin. He started with that imperfect system of sacrificing bulls and goats and sheep and lambs and birds and everything else that people were allowed to sacrifice for their sins. However, the writer of Hebrews tells us in Hebrews 10:4, it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. So this system was put in place in the Old Testament so that people could understand just what their sin did, to see the death that it brought with it, to see the punishment that they truly did deserve. Well, then we come to the perfect sacrifice that we celebrate this Holy Week, this Easter. This sacrificial system that God put in place found its fulfillment in Jesus. It found its perfection in Jesus. When we talk about Jesus being our substitute, dying in our place, there's two words that are very often used, fancy words that aren't in everyday language, to talk about this substitution. The first word that we use is expiation. And whenever we talk about this part of Jesus' sacrifice, we understand that on the cross, Jesus took away our guilt from us. That guilty verdict that was thrown at us, that guilty verdict that says we deserve death, that we deserve separation from God, that truly we deserve what we call hell, that guilt was removed from us. We see as far as the east is from the west, it should never touch. And we see that those deeds are no longer held against us when we come into court. And that's the first part of any forgiveness. The forgiveness that we're commanded to give really mainly commands that part, that we don't hold any offenses against anyone that we are trying to forgive. That if somebody has harmed us, somebody has insulted us, somebody has, you know, wronged us in any way, we are called not to hold that against them, not to hope for bad things for them, but to hope for the best. And so that's the first part of that forgiveness that Jesus gave us. That's the first part of what was done on the cross. But then we come to that second part of what he did when he substituted for us. That's what we use the word propitiation for. And with propitiation, not only are our sins removed from us, but our relationship with God has been reconciled. We have forgiven many people, hopefully we've forgiven many people, but that doesn't always mean that the relationship is healed. Many times we've forgiven somebody from a distance. We hold no ill will, we don't hope bad for them, we hope for their best, but we still don't want to have a friendship with them. We still are too offended, too hurt at times, even after hoping for their best, to really want to invite them over for dinner or to have any type of relationship with them. Well, with propitiation, Jesus took care of that part too. And not only has God forgiven us, he has adopted us as his children. And we are no longer under God's wrath, but we are under his love and forgiveness and have a relationship with him. So on the cross, Jesus took that guilty verdict, Jesus took that punishment that we deserved, he took God's wrath on him. And we see that while the cross was grotesque, not only did he take our sins there, but he took the rejection from God that our sins deserve so that we did not have to. Paul goes on to tell us, "For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God and are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by his blood, to be received by faith. This was to show God's righteousness, because in his divine forbearance he had passed over former sins. It was to show his righteousness at the present time, so that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus."
When I survey the wondrous cross,
Is the power of
God not only forgive us, but go to such great lengths to reconcile us to himself? Why would Jesus agree to leave heaven, to leave his glory, to be humbled, to come in the form of a baby, to live as a common man for 33 years, spend 3 of those years in intense ministry, only to be rejected, beaten, and crucified? Well, let's see if Scripture can offer an answer for God's motivation behind all of this. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. God shows his love for us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. God, being rich in mercy because of the great love in which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. See what kind of love the Father has given to us, that we should be called children of God, and so we are. Anyone who does not love does not know God, because God is love. In this, the love of God was made manifest among us, that God sent his only Son into the world so we might live through him. In this love, not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. I struggled for a long time with 1 Corinthians 13:13, when it says, these three remain, faith, hope, and love, but the greatest of these is love. I didn't understand how that could be the greatest over hope and faith. By grace we've been saved through faith, not of ourselves. It's a free gift of God. So when we're saved by our faith, how is love greater than that which saves us? Well, we understand that our faith in God is not saving faith unless he first loved us. We see his entire motivation for sending his Son to die on the cross for our sins was his love, and is his love for us. So God's motivation is to forgive us. It's completely explained by his love for us. Now, it is hard for us to hold the two ideas of God's wrath and judgment, as well as God's love and forgiveness, in our head at the same time. But we have to understand that while we deserve punishment, God's love says he does not want us to see that. The Bible tells us it is God's will that all should live, that all should come to him. And so I just have to say, thank God he loves us.
How he loves us.
Thank you. Oh,
is your bodies as living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. Therefore is a very important word when it shows up in Scripture. As the saying goes, when you see the word therefore, you need to go back and see what it's there for. In this case, Paul has just spent 11 chapters, I know he didn't write chapters, but for us, he has just spent 11 chapters telling us the good news of Jesus. He has just spelled out in Romans 1 through 11 the answer to the question that the rich young ruler had asked Jesus. What must I do to inherit eternal life? Romans 1 through 11 is perhaps the most succinct, most well laid out explanation of the gospel. In fact, many people first hear the good news through what we call the Romans Road, picking a few verses out of Romans that very well summarize what we mean by the gospel and what it means to be saved and how we can be saved. And so we just have to ask the question, if in Romans 1 through 11, Paul explains the gospel and explains what we must do to be saved, why does it go on for another 5 chapters? Why do Romans 12 through 16 even exist if Romans 1 through 11 is sufficient for us to know how to be saved? Well, therefore, we see that because of Romans 1 through 11, because Jesus died for our sins, because we have the chance to be redeemed, therefore, we have new lives. If we believe the gospel, the Bible tells us that's enough to be saved. Our faith, our belief, is what saves us through Christ. But we all know that if we actually believe something, if we truly believe something, it's going to change something about our lives. In this case, it should change everything about our lives. If we have come to the point where we admit that we had a fallen nature, that even our good deeds in our eyes were still nothing to God. They were still dirty rags to God. Because even our best deeds on our own are filled with selfishness and filled with pride. And even possibly the smallest part of it is still self-serving in some way. So we see Paul say, if you're truly saved, therefore your entire life should be turned over to God as a living sacrifice. That the old has gone, the new has come. We have died to ourselves. We have taken up our cross daily and followed him. The Bible says it in so many ways. And so our lives should not be unchanged. Does this mean we become legalistic? Does this mean we run around trying our hardest to get to know the law and obey every part of it? And where the law seems incomplete and insufficient to us, we add more rules? No, that's what got the Pharisees in trouble with Jesus. What we see is, when we believe in an omnipotent, sovereign God of the universe that has taken our place in punishment, our worship of him, our love for him, should demand complete devotion in every part of us. What does that look like? Well, that's what we spend our time in Scripture searching out. That's what we tend to spend our time in prayer, trying to understand the will of God and trying to discern what he has for us to do and how he has for us to live. There are some very great commons that we should all love each other, we should all love God with everything that we have, and I think there's things that we all agree on that are right and wrong very obviously, but the closer we grow to God, the further we should grow from this world. So we see this world is constantly trying to turn us away from God, and that's why we offer ourselves as living sacrifices, turning away from this world and towards God. We must seek to be holy as he is holy, and all we are must be surrendered to all that he will make us.
There's a place where
Life The resurrected life we celebrate today is not marked by misery and despair. But his peace is different. It is not the peace the world offers, he says. All around us, we see a world that is trying to treat symptoms of our pain with acute solutions. Entertainment and materialism serve to distract us from the fear, depression, anxiety, dissatisfaction, and pain that we are experiencing. Our culture has made an industry out of self-help, self-esteem, motivational books, shows, and conferences. There are numerous sermons designed in just the same way. Won't we be hard-pressed to say why we need a Savior if we are as inherently great as so many preach? Well, Scripture says the world is fallen, and humanity is fallen. While there are graciously things in this world that can bring happiness, none of them brings joy and satisfaction. Everything in this world is temporary. Jesus came to bring us victory over death, but just as much to bring us a victorious, true life. He says, the thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. We are blessed with a victory over this fallen world. Let us not return to its ways, and let us not seek to return to slavery when we have been freed. Let us live victorious lives. I tell you this, brothers, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. For this perishable body must put on the imperishable, and this mortal body must put on immortality. When the perishable puts on the imperishable, and the mortal puts on immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ.
My victory.
Oh,
worshiping with us this Easter. Let's close our word of prayer. So Lord, we just thank you so much for your sacrifice. Thank you so much for taking our place on the cross. Thank you for the hope we can have because of your resurrection, that we know that death is not the end. Even when we look around us and we're fearful about the unknown, Lord, help us to be joyful and help us to see the victory in what we do know for sure. That wherever this world may go, however our end may come, Lord, we really have no end. We will see you in your glory and spend eternity with you. And Lord, we cannot thank you enough for this, and help us to live lives that are worthy of you and that glorify your name.